This is Maharajas of Skill, a podcast where we go behind the scenes and talk to founders who are demolishing the myths around building and scaling a big business in India. These are the stories that have shattered the assumptions around Indian consumers and are changing the game completely. I am Krishna Jonakadla, serial entrepreneur, co-founder of Flit, the fashion locator in town, and startup mentor, bringing you these stories. Hey everyone, we are live again, and I'm super thrilled to say that we are live with the Maharani of Scale. We are live with Neha Suyal of Woobly. We've been trying to get her to talk with us for some time now. It's a space I'm a little intrigued and then perplexed about. Woobly started off as a bucket list platform for those folks that have watched the Morgan Freeman and Jack Nicholson movie will know what a bucket list means. It is that set of crazy ideas that you have that you'll someday do when you no longer have fears or have fulfilled all your familial duties, as the Bhagavad Gita says. So hundreds and thousands of people created their bucket lists on Woobly. But before we hit the record button, Neha talked about a pivot. So I'm going to save the story of the pivot and how they actually ended up where they are right now till we actually get Neha to talk about it. Neha, welcome to the show. It's so good to have you.
Thank you so much.
Awesome. Tell us a little bit about yourself and what you're working on right now.
Okay, perfect. So I think a personal story, I come from a very small town named Kitcha. It's very tough to pronounce itself. Again, from a personal friend, have been in a family of all the teachers. So even my family wanted me to be a teacher, which was something which I never wanted to do though. And kind of being an engineer, worked with HP for a very long time. My story actually started in a Stanford program. So Woobly actually started in a Stanford program. Post my HP, I did a short-term course with Stanford, which was into entrepreneurship and leadership. And that's where I ended up meeting my current co-founder, Venkat. So we kind of, in those 3 to 4 months of time, we were jumping a lot of ideas. And that's where the seed of Woobly started. We pitched it to Stanford professors. They kind of liked the whole idea of bucket listing. And they were the one who motivated us to actually kickstart. So this was back in 2015. That's when I did the course. Post that, what I did was I actually joined my co-founder's company itself, which is Quest Corp, India's largest business services company right now. Joined there, worked for 2 years there, was heading their business primarily from a tech point of view. So I have been a tech person all through my life. So I was helping them to kind of use technology solutions and increase their net margins. That's what was my core focus. Did that for 2 years, 2.5 years. Then 2017 end is when kind of took a call to exit and then start Woobly. So for us, I think we did the incorporation for Woobly much before we started working on Woobly.
So the Stanford program, was it on campus at Stanford?
So it was not. So it's a Stanford Ignite program, which is actually now no more there in India. They did it. They used to do it long back, wherein there were professors who would fly down from Stanford campus to India, Infosys campus in Bangalore. So we would have classes like Friday, Saturday, Sundays. So it was primarily for business people who were working. So we had age group from 24 till 55 years. So you would have CXOs plus you would have early people also. So it was a fun.
So a bit of a digression, but yeah. Let me still ask you this. Now that you are, then you were a wannabe entrepreneur.
That's right.
And you are an actual entrepreneur now.
Yeah.
And tell me, now that you've gone through that program, while Stanford is famous for all the behavioral labs and all the support that it offers entrepreneurship, so what did you find different about that program? Was it worth it? Was it on spot? Was it on point? How is it now that you're a real entrepreneur, if you were to contrast what you learned there?
So I would say that I would recommend it to anybody or everybody. Honestly, okay. the way we had our sessions was amazing because it was not like you see in India specifically. I'm sorry, I'm going to be very, very blunt, but it's not very bookish. Every session we had was a case study on a company, on a firm, wherein how did they solve a problem which they had. It can be a marketing problem. It can be a finance problem. It can be a business problem. So each one of those sessions, right, did help us in something, in figuring out something. How did companies actually? So it was a, I remember one session when a professor was telling us a story of diamond, that how the first marketeer sold diamond to be what it is today. So pretty interesting.
Interesting. So you were also revved up after you did that. And that's when you were like, oh gosh, I can't believe entrepreneurship couldn't be so exciting. So then I'm going to team up with someone. Is that how you and Venkat came together? Or?
Not really. See, for us though, I think Venkat has been an entrepreneur, right? So before this Woobly, he built this company named Quess Corp, which is India's largest business services company. They're listed in BSE and NSE both. Yeah. So yeah, pretty big. Much before that also, I think he was the Indian founding team for Adecco. So he has been building companies. In an honest conversation, I remember, One fine day, I was sitting in Quest office. He was director at that time, of course. And I sit in his office and ask him bluntly, saying that, so do you want to die as a director? Or do you want to do something again? That was my point blank question. And he looks at my face and say that, oh my God, somebody I hired is asking me this kind of question. So yeah.
Sounds so stories. Corny. It sounds straight like how Steve Jobs asked John Scully, do you want to sell sugar water for the rest of your life, or do you want to come change the world with me?
That's right. So that was a very straight question. And we started from there. So I think that got him thinking that, okay, fine, this is built, this is already IPO'd, so maybe I should start something new. So yeah.
Interesting. And what sort of ideas did you thrash around at that time?
So honestly, Krishna, we had, I think, I don't remember, in those 3 to 4 months of time during Stanford itself, I think we worked on almost 4 to 5 ideas. When I say ideas, we did not just work on it, we did research, we kind of made a presentation, presented it to people, and then took a call, do we want to go ahead or not. Woobly starting story is also very, very interesting, like you were talking about Morgan Freeman. I think one fine day, the kind of jobs we had, Venkat kind of comes home in the middle of the night from a trip from somewhere else. And then at 2 o'clock in the night, he calls me up and says that, hey, have you watched this movie Bucket List? And the first thing I say is, are you mad? This is 2 a.m. in the morning. And why are you calling me? Just hang up the phone. So I hung up the phone. And next day morning, before even kind of we start the day, I do my research and I go back and tell him, saying that, I think there is a gap. There is no platform which is helping users to list down their list and then, of course, also helping them to fulfill it, right? That's where the conversation started. And that's how we started working on the idea.
Interesting. And then how long did it take? So this was in 2015 when you were considering this, or 2017?
So 2015 is when we first time discussed about it. But then, okay. Of course, I joined Quest, and being the director of Quest, Venkat had that 3 years kind of a thingy when he can't come out of the company. Because if you're a founder, okay, right, in a listed company. So 2017 end is finally when we put that on a hold. We were doing a lot of background research. 2017 end is when we kind of came out of Quest, started working on it, two of us from a co-working space, like every founder starts, right? And then 2018 is when we started building the team and building the product. So 2019, okay, February is when we launched our first product.
Oh, that's a reasonable amount of time.
Yeah.
Okay, so talk to us about that journey, the research that you did,
okay,
and what exactly did you find? Because I'll tell you, I'll play devil's advocate for a second. And there's a friend of mine who's a pretty big dog in a Austin-based tech company.
Okay,
and what he did was he invested in a startup which actually uncovers hidden places around tourist spots, right? And this is way back in 2012. So he started investing in it in 2012. So what they would do is, let's say you were traveling to Mysore.
Okay.
In Mysore, there are places that you already know.
Yeah.
You can go to TripAdvisor and you'll find places. But then if you were to travel with a local, the local would actually tell you, hey, this is a point where everybody goes to, but this is a part that nobody is aware, or maybe very few people are aware. They started looking at places like that, and they started listing that. And I thought it was a pretty cool concept back then. And then eventually there were 4 or 5 of the clones of, his was a clone of something else. Then I looked at experiences. I looked at dining out. So I thought at around 2017, 2018, maybe this space might have looked a lot more crowded. Mm-hmm. So walk me through that thought process where you, the bucket list, there is all way back in the early 2000s, there used to be a list called the top 100 experiences.
That's right.
And I still remember because one of my friends used to love the Landmark Forum. If you know what the Landmark Forum is.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was rated, I think, number three in the world at that point in time. So we would constantly go back and look at that list of three experiences. And then people would make sub lists of that saying, okay, if I were to do it, the top 10 or top 20 for me would be something like this. Not exactly a bucket list, but I think something close in terms of experiences that they would like to have. So I would imagine that by 2017, 2018, this was possibly a space that was served, if not by one exclusive player, maybe in bits and pieces by multiple players.
Yeah.
So what was your thought process? How did you rationalize that this is something that we absolutely have to do?
Got it. So I think, I mean, much before we started, even when we were doing the research, right? What we realized is people relate bucket list to a lot of, like you just did, right? To a lot of what you call the travel and adventure experiences. But bucket list is not just that. My bucket list can be as simple as I want to, a very weird bucket list maybe. I want to try snake blood.
Sure.
That's not in travel adventure, right? I may have to go outside my house to try that, but still a very different bucket list. So what we realized is, yes, there are a lot of platforms who are serving the travel experience or an adventure experience. Adventure experience was still not very, what you call that, structured. Travel is structured, adventure is not structured in India still. So Then what we did, Krishna, actually was before even we launched the product, you asked me, right? Oh, it's a quite a big time, like any year almost before you guys actually launched. Yes, because we did not launch the product. What we did was very simple when we started writing. We just had content writers, and they started reaching out to people who have accomplished their bucket list.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And we started writing about them. So in that 1 year period, we almost wrote 1,000 plus stories. We started getting a lot of what you call that. We did a very simple thing. We had a small WordPress website wherein we started writing about people, their stories, and then we had simple get featured button. So anybody who wants to get featured, tell about their stories, they would just click on that, they would write. I think if you know, there is one singer who sings in male and female voice named Sri Ramayya.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very famous singer. He was the one so a lot of people like this, even a lot of maybe many celebrities whom we would have featured, but for their bucket list. There was a very interesting story I remember. It was an adventure, but still there was a boy from Lucknow who used to earn barely 15,000 rupees a month. He always had this bucket list of going to Dubai and doing skydiving. He saved for 4 years to be able to do that, and he did that. Right. So stories like these, which were not out and open, because you and I would write about known people, but we would not write about those people, right? So that's where it started. We started with Get Featured. We realized that people want to share their stories, but they are not heard yet. Then we started with, again, a very small button. So this conversation, you would, maybe listeners can learn more about product, right? How did we start bringing in the product in our complete scenario? We came up with very small button, which had add to wish list or add your bucket list, right? Very simple. We launched it, I remember, during just before Christmas. And we saw that just in one day, we had almost 1,000 plus people organically who wrote their bucket list. Starting from anything to anything. It was for a person of an age group of 20, 21, it was getting into Harvard. For somebody else, it was doing scuba diving or skydiving. It varied, right? That's where all of it started. So we realized that people are looking for a platform wherein they can write, or they can say that, hey, this is my own profile. I have a professional profile, which you can see in LinkedIn. And I have a matrimonial profile, which you can see in those matrimonial sites of the world. But I also have a personal profile, in which is nothing but the things what I have done or what I want to do. So if you want to know about me, that's how it started. People were like, okay, you want to know about me? This is my profile. I have been a hiker. I have been a scuba diver. I have been a jumper. And now I want to be a foodie in future. So that's how it translated. Even the idea translated like this. So yeah.
So pretty interesting. So it's like I constantly keep thinking people have different versions of themselves, right? You have a LinkedIn version of you where you've stripped away all emotional and personal stuff and said, I'm XYZ at ABC place. And
that's
then
right.
you have this social media version. And then there is this really, I don't want to use the, for the lack of a better term, I'll use the uncensored version. which is let me hide it away from some of the people that are going to judge me and then say, dude, you can't do this, or girl, you can't do this. And it sort of sounds like, in some sense, you gave license to some of those users to say, hey, it's okay to dream and it's okay to have a bucket list. And look, there are a thousand other people who seem to have been there, done that. So therefore, now that you've already seen that it can be done, go ahead and then speak your mind and then put a list out there.
That's right. My early user, I remember, was a girl. She did not know how to ride a bicycle. And that was her bucket list. So she came and wrote saying that, you know what, after I joined Woobly, I learned bicycle at the age of 24, which would have sounded otherwise not possible. But I did that because the moment I wrote this bucket list, a lot of people started writing their experience at a much later stage also when they learned. So yeah, stories like these.
But let me ask you a different question.
Yeah.
How did you come up with this thought saying, hey, let's go out? Was it a random experiment which said, okay, before we think about the product, let's understand what people actually do or what sort of things people are doing? How did you get how did you start getting this content? What was the process you followed?
Okay, so it was a lot of research. It was a lot of data also, right? So if you see the reports, which can be the travel or the adventure reports of India or outside India, global reports also, there never was before 2017 or so that a bucket list word as a word was mentioned anywhere. When now in the reports, when we saw those 2017, 2018 reports, people have literally mentioned saying that there are reports which talks about people's bucket list, reports which say that if a traveler or if an adventure seeker or if anybody is doing one bucket list this year, when they are doing accomplishing their bucket list, they already look to do two more bucket lists in the coming year. So that's the sense of accomplishment, what it brings for those users, right? That kind of gave us a kick, which means that industry is moving from a typical travel to experience to something bigger, which is also about things what I always wanted to do. So that was one data. Second data also, if you see, even India, from India point of view, right? Industry was always travel focused. There would be a lot of travel reports, state-wise, country-wise. Later in, what we realize is, again, in the same 2016-17 report, Indian government itself separated the travel from adventure or local experiences. So they had separated that, which means there was a ministry which was supposed to be formed for just local experiences, which is nothing but adventure. That again gave us a kick saying that, okay, fine, there is something which is getting built, which is coming up. So now this market is not a very conventional market wherein people are just looking to go to places or hidden places. People are looking for something more. They are looking for things what they want to do there, which is nothing but their bucket list. That's how, these are the data which backed it up, and that's how we came up with the idea.
So that part I got. I'm glad you actually laid it out in a little more detail. But so what I'm actually focused on is the tactic that you employed. Let's get a story out per day, or maybe a story out every other day, wherein you reached out and got that content. Was it always, so I like to think of some tactics like the cue ball on a billiards board or a snooker board, right? So the white ball is what you're hitting, but that's not your goal. Your goal is actually eventually to hit something else. Was this one of the growth tactics that you employed, which you thought would eventually hit where you would want to hit?
It was. So honestly, Kisha, we both of us as a founder, full-time founder, we come from a very conventional background. I mean, if you see the company which Venkat Bill or I was in, we were always like, I have to be profitable from day one, that kind of a mindset, right? That's why he could build that $1.5 billion kind of a company. And then when we started this, we know that we are getting into a very different segment, which is a B2C segment. You can't think of making profits from the day one, right? Very, very different segment. You have to do, you would understand that. So, but one thing what we were very particular about was, first is getting those initial users. Second, not spending money on just Facebook or Google ads, because then we would not learn anything. I have seen a lot of founders say that, right? You want to run an MVP, just spend money on Facebook or Google. But then what happens is, I don't really learn that what organic users would do. I only learn that when I'm paying money to somebody else, what is happening, right? So we were very particular about not doing that. And that was also a stage when we had to build a product. So we know that development is going to take time. Even for us to even structure out how the product should come, it's going to take some time. We did not want to sit idle, and we knew that we have to do marketing much before that without spending a huge chunk of money just to do marketing on other platforms. So content marketing became our primary focus, which still is a very primary focus for us to scale, right? So what we said is, how about we want people to write bucket list, right? That's what we want. We want people to write bucket list and further accomplish it on Woobly. So much before that, people have to know what is bucket list in India. Is there even enough content around that? That's when we thought, how about writing a story? And there was a metric related to that also. If I'm writing a story about one person, which is organically writing, I know that that person is going to share on all their social media platforms because the person is very excited about it, very proud about it, right? So what we started seeing was, from a metric point of view, every share which a person would do organically, we would get 200 to 300 people on our website reading that story. So that was organic, right? And then we would also get that every 4 to 5 stories we launch, we would also get people who are reaching out to us and saying that, hey, can you feature me also? So now I don't have to worry about creating that demand because somebody else is reaching out to me and saying, write about me. And somebody else is doing the content distribution also. So that was the main point that we started doing that. So by the time we started writing, we realized that we already are getting into from zero traffic to almost in the third month itself, I remember we hit 50,000 users visiting our website. And all of it happened because there were so many people who were organically sharing their stories to others. So that was the whole metric. And then we started introducing the features one by one.
Very interesting. So talk about that evolution, the features, and what did you introduce first, next?
So I think the very first was, like I said, get featured, wherein we realized that doing it very manually is not going to be effective. Wherein we are finding out people, we are reaching out to them. We just introduced a feature, we said get featured. People started reaching out to us. So we got into a state wherein on a daily basis, we are getting at least one inquiry. So we don't have to worry about reaching out to people. That's one. Second, then we introduced add to bucket list, add your bucket list, right? Or your new year bucket list. That kind of gave us that kick that, oh, people are interested in writing. Because we had this question always, people have bucket lists, will they write it? That was the second question we had, right? And people proved that, yes, they would write it. They would write their list, right? And they would also want to keep coming back to it. So that's what we launched, Add to Bucket List. We were a web platform. Then we thought, how about just start showcasing these bucket lists, everybody's bucket list. Then we saw that people started engaging on others' bucket list or started adding. So let's say now Krishna has a bucket list, Neha has a bucket list. Neha comes to Krishna's page, look at it and see, oh, this is interesting. Let me add that also. So next become adding to somebody else's bucket list, people started adding. So that became a next feature. So like this, we started kind of improvising and moving from.
Awesome. Awesome. And then at what, so we all know B2C, like you said, the monetization comes at a later stage. But then again, there are types of B2C businesses that can be monetized, because ultimately it's about at what point you provide value. But to be fair, I think on the internet, given the number of so-called free sites that are available that let you do anything and everything, you're actually particularly challenged because you have to work really hard to establish yourself that, yes, you know what? I need to charge you for it, and therefore you need to pay me. Yeah. And there's also this tricky decision of when to monetize. There is a possibility of monetizing too soon and killing off that growth. And there is also a possibility, especially in these kinds of startups where you're content driven, especially where you're user generated content driven. UGC is a big deal, right? So UGC, the floodgates have to remain open for quite some time. And almost it has to be some sort of an afterthought, saying people have to think, I can't believe they haven't monetized it yet. That kind of a question has to dawn. So then did you monetize it? At what point of time? What were your plans for it?
So honestly, we launched the platform in February 2019. That was when we launched our app, right, to the users. And we started monetizing from the same year, October 2019. There's a reason for that. What we realized from the day one is we are not an entertainment platform. We were never that. Even now, we are not an entertainment platform. We were more of an infotainment platform. Users were coming to create their list, and users were also coming to look at how others are doing their list. So it was always that, right? So in the number sense, I might not get to that 200, 300, 400 million kind of a user. I might have lesser users, but they will always be very targeted. Because now they're not telling me, hey, today I woke up and I had coffee. They are telling me that, you know what, these are 20 things I did in my life, and these are 20 things which I want to do in my life. and also with whom I want to do in my life. So people would also write saying that, you know what, let's take an example of adventure just for an easy conversation. I want to do scuba diving in Dubai with my partner in 2019 December. So people would talk at this length, right? Because they are very serious about it. So anymore, it's not a user who would have done 100 events before even telling me what they want to do. Here, people are saying out loud what they really want to do, and then trying to find the knowledge to do that. So that was one big reason, right? People were very, very targeted. That's one. Second, so what we did was, when we realized this, is we also had the same thought, like you said, no, that maybe when I get to 10 million users, I would start doing revenues. But then we realized that we are not going to be an ad platform. That's not what we are building. For us, it was like, come and list your bucket list and we will help you or enable you in accomplishing it. Right? How do we enable in accomplishing it? We did not want to be a make my trips of the world. We were more of a compliment, because we are not going to sell the packages then and there, same way, right? We said that, okay, fine. To start with, we said we will focus on one category, which was last mile service providers who are not currently available anywhere else. So when I say last mile service providers, I'm talking about the Chaku or who's running a boathouse in Kerala. Right now, when you go to any other platforms, you would see the middleman or the Taj or the hotels instead of the Chaku, right? So we started bringing in those Chakus of the world. That's how we started monetizing. So in the October 2019, we had, between those months, we had almost 150 plus operators, those last mile service providers who were there on the platform, and they started getting sales organically because people are looking for those experiences. We did make revenues in those 3 months. And of course, all of us know what happened in the month of February 2020, and kind of all of that stopped. That's when the COVID hit, and that's when Woobly also changed, or I would say, I would not say pivot, because even when we were in bucket list, people were not writing just about travel or adventure. People were writing a lot of DIY, a lot of fashion, a lot of beauty and personal care list also, things what they want to buy. So people would say a lot of luxury items, like I want to buy a Rolex watch, right? Which is not travel or adventure. So we had plans to move to other categories. I think COVID kind of kicked it off, made that plan to be like 12 months or 18 months prior. And in the month of March, we took a call that let's start focusing from content point of view to those categories and then see how the growth is going. So from being that, we kind of moved to a social commerce for beauty and personal care. That's what we are focusing on now.
We'll talk about that pivot a little more detail. But I want to cover your personal journey a bit. Kichha is the name of the town, you said. Which state is it in?
Kichha. It's in Uttarakhand, district of Udhamsingh.
I've been to Uttarakhand 2019, I think. Around the time you were busy launching your platform. So beautiful state, especially it's got all the Chardham spiritual locations. Very picturesque also.
It's beautiful. So which
went
part of Uttarakhand?
Kedarnath and Badrinath, and
beautiful place.
I mean, both of them, and we did this in the month of October. So, and I'm a big fan of snow-capped mountains and snow peaks. Lived in Chicago for a long time, which tires you of the snow, but still I never lost the feeling of romance that I had for snow, peaks and valleys, and all the tributaries of the Ganga, the estuaries of the Ganga. It's fantastic. It's so funny, all those unions or the sangams, the five different prayags, as they are known.
It's
practically overlooking the Prayag, and you can see both the rivers merging. The most stark one is where Bhagirathi and Alaknanda meet, and Alaknanda is literally that aquamarine green, and then Bhagirathi, which is actually the main Ganga, right? So together they become, it becomes the Ganges or Ganga. But Ganga still doesn't have the luster of Alaknanda, right? So it's a sight to behold. Yes. So did you grow up there? Did you grow up in those parts? Or?
So I grew up in the town named Kichha, right? Honestly, I have been there all through my life, mostly. My grandparents, so parental place is in a place named Ramgarh, which is again towards the hilly side, famous for apples, famous for dry fruits. So yeah, that's a place. Did I go there often? No, not really. I've been mostly in the town. I used to go there once in 2 to 3 years kind of stuff, but not to live long. But I would say luckily I ended up doing my studies from this REC Dwarahat. So which is of course above Raniket. From Raniket Manar, it's Dwarahat is a place. There you would see these snow-capped mountains kind of thing. So if you go from there, there's a place some 20 kilometers named Pandu Kholi, which is, there is a history behind that. They say the Pandavas, they came and kind of were there. So 5 Pandavas. So there, when you go during the winter time, right, it's filled of snow. Amazing.
So,
amazing.
So how did you end up in Bangalore and the Stanford program?
So what happened was from the starting, so I come from a very, I would say middle class or lower middle class kind of family, right? We were not very well to do back then. Now we are, yes, but not back then. So from the time when I did my engineering, I remember giving my, I always wanted to do my higher studies. So I remember giving my GRE, GMATs, and of course that time CAT and all of those things, right? But then I decided that no, I really want to work and then kind of do something for my family before even I take a call to do my higher studies. So that was one of the reasons I said, fine, let's go and do job first, and ended up being in Bangalore. I think Bangalore is a dream city for people living in tier 3, tier 4, tier 2, right? I mean, you see that Bangalore is a Silicon Valley of India. So you go there, you will get a job. I had a job in Infosys and TCS before even came to Bangalore. So it was my fall safe kind of a thing. Even if you don't get a job, you can do a job. Luckily, the first interview I gave was in HP and I got it. So I worked with HP for almost 5 years. And during that time, I was preparing for GMAT. I did get my GMAT also. It was again a very emotional kind of a story. I did give my GMAT. Was to go outside, but that was the same year when my kind of dad passed away. So I took a call not to go outside India at all. I think that's where Stanford happened. So during the same time, got this application for Stanford Ignite, and I was like, okay, fine, why not? Let me give it a try. I knew I wanted to go to Stanford. If not there, let me have the course here. So yeah.
Nice. A family loss actually turns into a blessing.
Yeah, true. Right. Fine.
Interesting. And so obviously you and Venkat were in this program.
That's right.
And how did the, where you are, did you develop a rapport in the program? Did you see that he was a little different, or how, when did that whole thing about, hey, we need to do something together, or at least having respect, because two people coming together and doing a venture actually means that they've come to appreciate each other's point of view and something about that other person.
That's
when they've decided, okay, let's do this crazy adventure together called a startup.
Yeah, that's right.
We'll see how it goes. So how did that happen?
So honestly, I think Venkat and my story is very funny in all the sense. The thing what I told him when I was sitting in his cabin, same thing, right? I remember when we started the program. So the Stanford program itself is structured in a way wherein you are a group of 50 people who are there in the session, and then you're divided into multiple subgroups. Subgroups is nothing but each group of between 5 to 6 people work on a business idea, from business idea till you kind of present it in front of VCs. So that's how it was presented, right? And Venkat and I were in the same subgroup. But interestingly, what I realized is in the first few days itself, because they being the directors of a company, he had a very clear objective of coming to that session for hiring some good people from here. So they wanted to hire some, that was the motive, right? I think that's how I got hired also. So it started from there. And during those 4 months, of course, because we were working on the business ideas, taking it to a, where you are presenting it to a VC, right? We did a lot of those things together. So towards the end, it kind of, I realized that, I think it's knowingly or unknowingly, both of us start spending a lot of time in working on different ideas and then kind of presenting it to people. That's how it started. And then, of course, I got and joined his own company. There again, we had this bug that had have to start something. I kind of pushed him to leave that high-paying good job and told him that let's do this kind of stuff. And yeah, we did it. And it was almost 2.5 years I worked with him, right? So you get that kind of a comfort that when you work together also that year.
You must have major convincing power.
I think so. Yeah, yes, it is. I think so. So I still remember he keeps saying that, you know what, when I joined this company, you said it's going to be easy. And he has been a photographer and a biker, and I have not done anything for the last 3 years. So, yeah. Yeah.
Time to dust off his bucket list.
actually, we were building a bucket list platform and both of us stopped doing our own bucket list. That's what happened.
You were just so busy helping everyone else fulfilling their bucket list, and you were just sticking only one on your list.
Right? That's right.
So let's talk about the we've already spoken about. I'm glad you spent, actually kicked it off with the story angle, because that gives a sense in understanding what the spark was.
Got it.
What I've found is most narratives begin after some amount of it's like, if I were to take the journey of a plant, there's the seed, you actually sow it, and for the first 2-3 weeks, you actually don't see anything above the soil.
Yeah,
right.
That's right.
And depending upon what you planted, of course, but for the most part, you don't see anything. And the normal human instinct, especially if you haven't done any gardening before, you don't know how those things work, is you dig and then you see, okay, what's happening with the seed. And then you realize that digging itself actually endangers the germination of that seed.
That's right. Yeah.
And then it becomes a sapling. And once it grows a little bit and start showing signs of bearing some vegetable or fruit, that's when you start taking it seriously.
Yeah, that's right.
Most startup narratives begin there. Yeah. And I'm actually a big fan of starting from the beginning, because to actually quote Kunal Shah of Cred, startups in the first 2 years suffer from what is called as a sudden death syndrome. It could die for a variety of reasons. But that also is a function of the fact that finding early growth is not an established science.
Yeah, true.
Right? When I, for our current startup, I've been talking to a variety of growth leaders, growth leads. And one of the things that comes back to me starkly is when somebody tells me, we'll do social media marketing and digital marketing, that completely convinces me that this person has no clue about how to even think about growing a product. And that possibly worked way in the late 2000s, and then maybe early part of the previous decade, 2011-12, when social media platforms offered organic growth, you just posted something, people liked, and you had followers. But now it is impossible. All you're doing is spinning your wheels without actually going anywhere. So if you could do a little more deep dive and talk about some inflection points. You already spoke about get featured and how you got some operators organically. If a couple more inflection points where you got from the first 1,000, how you hopped to the 100,000, and then beyond that, and what were some different tactics that you adopted there?
Okay. So I think I told you, right, that we have been very conventional in doing anything. And specifically as the founders also, I think we always had this this one very strong rule that if you want to implement something, first dirty your own hands. That's something which I learned from my current founder also. Dirty your own hands, see before even you're telling it to the team to implement that, if it's going to work, then, because only then you will also be able to measure, right. How things are going. So I think what we did first is our first 2000 users were actually very manually onboarded. So five of us in the office, we took a platform, which was a bucket list platform based out of US. We started reaching out to all the users from there very manually. We would find their names in Facebook. We would reach out to them, send a message, and saw that how it is going. What we saw is that once we reach out to somebody and explain the idea clearly, people were interested in being part of the platform. That's what we saw. But then we realized this is not going to be sustainable, because I can't take, let's say, 15 days or 20 days to just onboard 2,000 users, right? If you're in a B2C space. So again, what we did was very conventional. We said that we can't do it. Why don't we start working with freelancers? But it will not be typical freelancers. So we started building a lot of student strength. We thought that there are colleges which are MBA colleges. All of them look for digital marketing internship, because that was the era of, it still is an era of digital marketing and social media marketing, right? So talk to colleges, placement officers, tell them that we have internship for your students. All they have to do is social media marketing and digital marketing. That's what we did. So very conventionally, we started with that small 50 batch of students, wherein those students became our ambassadors. So they would reach out to people, they would start onboarding people. That's how the seed started. Honestly, in last few, two and a half, three years now, I have, I think, almost worked with 10,000 plus students and almost 1,000 plus colleges around India. Like, so we have a full-fledged team now, right, who does that. Now, what happened was, think of it, right? Let's say I'm in one college wherein I have one student who's a biking freak or who's a foodie, who's now talking about Woobly. And who's just talking about Woobly, who's saying that, you know what, I have a profile on Woobly, you want to know about me, go and check here. My bucket list are here. And people are very intrigued because, see, on other social media platforms, you can know what people have already done. You can never know what they want to do or what they're looking to do in their life. That's what started getting them here. And then they started hooking on here because they saw that what I wanted to do also is being done by somebody else. So it was a very kind of a content marketing push. These ambassadors started pushing. And then a lot of sharing and organic push started happening. So what I was seeing is, even in the early days, we saw that in the first 3 months also, almost 20 to 24% of our users were coming via pure App Store optimization. People are looking for bucket list kind of keywords and then they're coming and downloading the app. That's how we got from first 2,000 to 10,000, from 10,000 to 100,000 users. And honestly, after 100,000 is when we thought that, okay, I think we also need to scale. We can't just keep running this. Why don't we also spend some money in the paid marketing? So we did very small budget. I think I have seen this somehow, you know, every time we get into paid marketing, something or the other happens. So we kind of started doing the paid marketing. And then we realized that we were a wrapper plus native app back then. And then we realized that that's not going to give us very good retention. So we took a call to move to a native app for Android. So we kind of stopped paid marketing there. And then we said, let's focus on this. And then, of course, keep growing like this, right? Content marketing organically. We had ambassadors, we had influencers who were doing this. So we kind of kept growing like this. And then funding happened. I think like with every entrepreneur, it happened. The moment you get funding, you start looking at ways to scale. And one of the easiest way to scale is spending money on Google and Facebook. It's a very brutal truth, but that's what happens, right? All of us do that. So I think October 2019 is when we did close our funding. And we were also like, yeah, I mean, we just raised now. We have to show growth and scale. So we also started spending money, of course, on Facebook and Google. We spent 3 months, COVID happened, so kind of stopped again. But what we realized also, you know what, Krishna, that again, right, like I was saying earlier, the moment you stop paying, you stop getting anything. Is that right? If I pay today 10 rupees, I would get. If I don't, I would not get, right? So that's not scalable. Is that required? Yes, it's very much required. You cannot just scale on organic plus content marketing. It is required to couple your growth. Because I have seen it, I mean, I have seen it very closely that if I'm just doing organic, then I might get a 22% of the organic growth. The moment I couple it with a small budget also, my organic also increases. Because that's how these algorithms act, right? So even to couple or to grow your organic, you need to spend some money. So we started doing that. We started spending some money. That's how we did, I think, till we reached 900,000 users. From 100,000 to 900,000, we tried multiple channels. We tried advertisements. We tried using publisher network. I always had a very, very bad experience with publisher network. I feel the kind of users you get is extremely bad, extremely bad. So kind of did that for 2-3 months and took a call to stop it, right? And then COVID happened. So last year, March, we again took a call to not spend any money. So from that 900,000 to now 3.5 million, all of it is organic. And all of it is only via people, because now we move the platform also, right, to social commerce for beauty and personal care. So the way the product is built, it's very simple. Users are coming to Woobly. If they have a product or they buy a product, they create a content on that. And the system is built is very simple that when somebody clicks a video or an image, we auto tag that to a brand. So every content which comes on Woobly becomes a shoppable content. We have always been a very infotainment platform. We are still that. That intrudes users saying that, oh, I just upload a picture and they tell me which brand it is, auto tag which brand it is, and make them shoppable also. So now it becomes shoppable. If let's say now Krishna comes to platform, looks at Neha's content, buy it, kind of Neha gets a certain percentage commission of the GMV, which auto gets given to the Neha. So this kind of motivated a lot of users saying that all I have to do is I have a content, I have a product I'm using. If I create a content, Woobly takes care of auto tagging. Somebody else buy it, I'm still getting something out of it. And I'm also getting a lot of followers because of it, right? So there is a trust which is getting built. I'm still making something out of it. That's how the virality in content and sharing started. So what we started seeing is people who are creating content, at least 60 to 65% of them are also sharing it outside. And I saw that for every share, on an average, I'm getting at least 10 to 11 clicks. That number sounds small if it's just one person, but if that is 10,000 to 15,000 people, the number goes very high. So that's how we started getting a lot of users. Now that's how we are getting almost 150, 200,000 users a month just by doing this, motivating people to share.
Exceptional. So, and you've sort of teased the pivot because of COVID, maybe a shift instead of a pivot, perhaps. You were addressing a bunch of things and you realize that there is this personal care and personal development angle, which is what feeds into what you are looking at right now. When you made that decision, it's normal for entrepreneurs to say, we were looking at all of this data and the data told us this, and therefore we started traversing towards the data. In your case, seems like COVID has prompted that too. But when you decided to do the shift, am I right in assuming that COVID actually put paid to some of the plans that of your organic growth, and then therefore you thought this might be a good time to look at what are the bright spots that are there, and then make the shift? What was that process like?
So Krishna, I think you know what, like you were saying, right? That when you are doing a PR article, you would say all the glossy or a glamorous thing. But honestly, it was not easy, right? When you are holding on to an idea for so many years, it's not easy to just turn around and say that, you know what, no more bucket list, no more wish list, no more users saying that. I am going to just get into social commerce. It was not at all easy. It took us also a lot of time, right? We kind of also, I think for a month or so, we kind of sat every day and said that, what do we do, right? And COVID did a lot of things to a lot of people, right? I would still say thanks to our investors who were there part of it. It's good that they pushed us, because for everybody, there was a lot of commotion. Yeah, people didn't even know if your startup will sustain. And we know that a very high percentage did die, right? Because of COVID. Yeah, a lot of issue came. So for us also, what happened is from the growth, which was, so for us, we got funding 5 months back. The focus was growth till February, March. So I remember till March, mid also, when we were on the review calls, we were only told about grow. And suddenly from growth, the focus shifted to revenue, right? Because then you had to think of, was everything else is okay, but you have to sustain for a longer period of time. Even when we had a runway for a longer time, still we had to think about that. So there were a lot of angles. I would not say just COVID. There were a lot of angles, right? There was pressure, there was COVID, there was other opportunities. So a lot of those things. And then we were also trying to figure out, people are not going to talk about bucket list, right? If you keep saying, asking people, write your bucket list and just say, and because majority are writing in, let's say, adventure and travel, almost 60% was that, 40% was other categories. People would not come back to the platform. Because I can't just come to a platform during a lockdown, say, and just see a scuba diving video and feel good about it. People were not in that state during that time. So we kind of, I think it started from a content point of view. We said that, okay, fine. Let's just ask people that you also wanted to do list things in your fitness bucket list. You also wanted to do things in your cooking bucket list. Why don't you start writing those? So that's how the platform shifted. So we started focusing on those categories. Those categories came forward. But then we realized that if you see from a market point of view, fitness or food, again, there are so many players, a lot of those things, research, complexity, a lot of those things came into picture. So we finally said that, what is the next big thing which is coming up, which also resonates with our users and the way people are behaving on the platform? That's where I think we found this social commerce, specifically for beauty and personal care, as an opportunity. Because what happened was, for us, honestly, the reason we said we will only go with one category was because we also did not have so much cash to just spend and test in all the categories. We said, fine, let's just do stabilize in one category, see how users are behaving, and then take a call for other categories, which worked very well, I think, luckily also, because that was a time when there was so much of D2C boom happened. We moved to social commerce, and suddenly, if you see now, people are talking about D2C commerce itself. Not just e-commerce, there were two words in the market till now, e-commerce and social commerce. And as of today morning, I was seeing people talking about D2C commerce. Because there are so many D2C platforms because of your Atmanirbhar, because of your Indian, because of a lot more of those things that D2C has come into picture. And our focus was only that. So from a platform point of view, we started with that we will only be focusing on social commerce for the D2C platforms in beauty and personal care sector in India. Because we found a challenge or a problem, which was again very similar to what we were doing during bucket list time. See, in bucket list time, we found that these last mile service providers are not able to generate leads. They are sharing almost 15 to almost as high as 50% of their revenues just to generate sales leads, right?
Right.
Which is creating a lot of gap in the market. In this also, it's the same thing. So these D2C platforms, they can build products. They don't know how to market. They don't know how to do anything else, right? And their challenge is that currently with the mammoths, social media mammoths like Facebook or Instagram and previously TikTok, if they have to sell a product worth of 100 rupees, they end up spending almost 180 to 200 rupees to generate that sales, which means they're literally burning to even generate a rupee. They're not making any money. That's their biggest challenge. Nobody knows about, see, you like all of us see only success stories of Mama Earth and Mom's Co and Sugar, but they are only 3 or 4 or 10 boys.
Right.
There are thousands more products out in the market. So I think that was a challenge which we started, problem which we started solving. And that's where, again, we are able to scale. Because now we are able to create that USP that we are a platform for D2C brands of India in beauty and personal care sector. And users know very clearly that I'm coming here for entertainment for those set of brands.
Interesting. Awesome. What this actually tells me is, because when you speak about these nudges, right? Because it's essentially a nudge. You're actually telling them, hey, you given that majority of your bucket list was in adventure and travel, there are some other areas in your life as well, which right now can't get attention because of the way the world is right now. What this tells me is you had some sort of insight, visibility, and a dialogue going on with your users, or at least you had some sort of a process whereby you could say, I think I can nudge them to do this because I know they are going to be a little directionless at this point in time. Because all of a sudden COVID has put pay to anybody and everybody's basic plans, forget dreams for a moment. Basic life has just come to a standstill. So that tells me that that's possibly a very integral part of how you look at things, your users. It's kind of rare to hear something of that sort. Where does that come from? And talk about that process a little more.
So I think it's again from a point that it's how your mindset is, right? Like we said that we never wanted to just push in money in all the platforms available in the market and then say what is happening, right? We always wanted to do that very dirty your hands, see what is working, what is not working, and how it is performing. That's why instead of just spending, let's say, 10 lakhs a month on a Facebook or a Google campaign, we ended up creating that huge ambassador base of 10,000 students across India, which was not easy operationally. It's not easy to handle so many interns around India, right? But we ended up creating that just because we realized that if you have to communicate very clearly, you need somebody who would be able to do that, right? So that was one of the very big reasons, I think, that we never believed in just that kind of marketing. So we were always that we need to know what is happening. And from a user point of view also, what happened was in the product, if you see, when we were a bucket list platform, we were asking people that a very simple button, again, add to bucket list. That's what we were telling them. So there are content which people would come and see. If they like that, we would nudge them saying that add to your bucket list. We realized that when we are moving to other categories, it's not bucket list anymore. It's nothing but a wish list. So now I'm saying, when I'm showing, let's say, a D2C brand product, I'm saying, you like this content, you like somebody else using this lipstick, add to your wish list. So that bucket list moved to wish list from a product point of view. Now people are coming to Woobly, they're looking at somebody else's content, video or image, they are seeing how they are using those D2C brands. Let's say I am accustomed to using Lakmé, I'm seeing that, hey, somebody is promoting Iber Cosmetics or somebody is promoting Neuronome. I've never heard of these brands, but it looks interesting. Why don't I give it a try? That's how I start, because I look at a content, I see somebody authentic who's promoting that, or not promoting, communicating that via his or her content, and I say that, let me try it. So instead of just asking people buy now, we say that you add to your wish list. And if you're making a decision to buy, you can buy also here itself. There is an option for you to buy also. I think those are the very small changes which we started doing from a product point of view, which we saw resulted in this kind of growth also. It was just a content change, nothing else. Buttons stood the same, process stood the same, just the content change, which made us understand what people are. So behavior is still same. I'm still adding something to my list. It's just that I'm not adding bucket list, I'm adding a wish list now.
Right.
That's how it is, yeah.
Very interesting. What have been some trying moments and some cherishable moments in the last few years of this journey?
So I think I would say a lot of moments has come in last few months also. We launched this social commerce platform for beauty and personal care. And we were like kind of, even when we are targeting a very different kind of, we have a very different USP, very different crowd. Many people came and said that, you know what, you're still standing against the mammoths. Like, of course, you have Meesho's of the world. Right? I mean, with such a huge funding, they are catering to very different audience segment. They are into tier two, tier three. They are into fashion segment, very different housewives, right? So how is going to happen? What's going to happen? I think for us, a very good thing was, I remember that we launched the commerce for users in the month of September last year. And all organically, we are already doing almost, this month we would be touching almost $100,000 of GMV. Which is actually equivalent to the kind of GMVs which platforms with way higher funding raise, way higher stability, or way higher, I think, way later in their journey was doing. So few things like that, which kind of gives a lot of belief that, yeah, if you keep sticking to the users, what they want, keep bringing value to both sides of the value chain, you would still be able to be a player in your market. So, yeah.
No question about it. I think the biggest aspect when you have the foundational blocks right is that patience.
That's right.
That's the difference that I see. Of course, you have to keep executing. You have to keep believing. And there is this phrase called "keep on keeping on."
Yeah, that's right.
But that's where the hockey stick happens many times, right? The hockey stick growth, because there are so many posers out there, I would say, who are actually literally pushing things towards you. And all of a sudden, you come here and say, I'm going to nudge. I'm actually going to walk with you. And they look at you and say, no, this can't be happening. Is this person crazy or what? So it's a question of once bitten, twice shy. That whole trust equation, that leap takes a little more time. But then once it happens, a small leap actually translates into a giant one. And then the trust trajectory goes like this, which is why when you contrast ones which are heavily funded versus the one which what you're doing right now, which I think is the right way to do, because there's a difference between telling people and then asking people, right? Your version is asking, and then the other version is actually telling. Because I'm just simplifying it for the sake of discussion.
Yeah.
Because many times when you're heavily funded, you are sitting behind a pile of cash, right? And you also have a different kind of pressure.
That's right.
I remember in my previous startup, we ran some campaigns. And we saw that people would come purely for the incentive. And I said, just like you said, users that came from some of these
publisher
networks, they were not the desirable ones. The users that actually came purely for the incentive and then didn't come back, I didn't want that kind of a user. Mm-hmm. It actually told me two things. One is either the user is wrong, or I possibly am not offering enough value for them to actually consider me without enough incentive, right? So if they took the first incentive and came back the second time, what that tells me is the incentive is solving the awareness problem, right? It is not solving the value problem.
Hmm.
So when you're sitting on a mountain of cash, you've obviously had a lot of ideas saying, okay, this is how I can build the market. And somebody obviously believed in you, trusted you with that story and said, okay, go do that now. You've said you were going to do all of this. Here's your money. Go do that. And then while you are at it, make sure that you're the last man standing, so to speak.
That's
because
right.
most of these places, almost all of them are last man standing contests, right? Mm-hmm. The digital marketplace is a zero-sum game.
Yeah.
You don't have a number two in most places. It takes some amount of time for genres and differentiations to emerge. So for instance, in search, you have DuckDuckGo, which offers privacy, which is still a much, much distant fifth or sixth or whatever in that list, right? So I'm not surprised at what you are experiencing because you focused on the users, you got them to talk, you asked them, hey, what do you want to do? What's on your mind? And then you said, COVID's come along, maybe let's nudge and then do something.
Yeah.
And if you're doing this, so all along, it feels like you've been gently handholding them towards what they've wanted to do versus somebody who comes to you and I know what you want, here's what it is. And by the way, you know what? This is X times better and Y times cheaper. So trust me, I know what's best for you.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a different approach. So there are obviously people who don't know what they want.
Yeah.
And they'll obviously go into that bucket. And then there are sets of people who are like, no, dude, I got this. You know, I know what I want.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe what you are offering is not for me.
Yeah.
So I'm not surprised. So that's interesting. Do you ever see things that way?
Yeah, we do. So like, I think I've been telling you, right? You see, for us, we were always very, from a thought process point of view, we were always very straight that, you know what, we are not an entertainment platform. I remember when the COVID hit, right? I remember getting a lot of nudges from a lot of people. I'm talking about like maybe a peer investor, not just investors, entrepreneurs, a lot of people, right? That wherein people started kind of saying that, hey, this is the right time. TikTok is banned. COVID has hit. Everybody is talking about Indian platforms, why don't you guys kind of shift to be just an Indian content platform? I remember getting a lot of emails from TikTok stars in the regional language asking, saying that, hey, can I post my entertainment video, right? And we might have done that also, if we were not very clear and focused that we should still be. A lot of platforms did that, actually. I remember a lot of platforms converting suddenly from a very different focus to saying that, oh, we are a TikTok of India, right? But I think it took us a lot of, it took us a lot of focus, a lot of those multiple discussions day in and day in and day night, saying that, you know what, a lot of these things would come. But we said from the start that we will be the infotainment platform. We will be the platform wherein users, maybe not millions, hundreds of millions of users, but users would come for a very target content and they would be very targeted users for a targeted buying. That's what we said. And that's what I think worked for us. So that's why now, if you see from a number point of view, we may not have 40 million users, 50 million users, but we are still able to do the kind of GMV and revenue we are able to do is way better than many platforms who have way higher user base than us.
Right. So what do you foresee ending up this year with in GMV?
So honestly, I think now from April till next year, my target is pretty high. I'm looking at because we just started kind of social commerce revenue last 5 months, right? This month, I would be doing $100,000 from a GMV point of view. We are targeting that. How do we get to 5 million kind of ARR in next year? If we do that, I think we would become the first company in India from a social commerce point of view to be doing that so early. So yeah, that's the target. Let's see.
Pretty interesting. From a funding perspective, was it a different journey? You haven't raised money from the usual suspects.
So very different story. We were in the market thinking we would do a smaller round. We ended up doing in 2019, $2.5 million. So we had one investor who said that, you know what, I would kind of take the bigger round kind of stuff. So we did that. We are already closing our one more round now, pre-Series A kind of a round, and already in the market with basically have been speaking to some investors for the Series A also.
Interesting. In terms of culture, let me understand a sequence of how you built this, because what it gives me, the feeling that I get is that you first focused on the growth aspect of it, and then the product got built along the way. Would that be a appropriate characterization?
So I would, you can say that. I mean, we have not, honestly, when we launched, right, instead of the basic features, we did not define saying that these are 10 features which would come in the app. We did not, right? Because we said that, okay, this is what we want to communicate to the user. And let's start building in small, small things and testing what users are actually liking. And then, of course, depending on what users were liking, we started bringing in a much more better form. That's the reason that for almost 1 year, we did not have native app. We were on the Wrapper Plus native app. And then we took a call in 2020 saying that, okay, we need a native app now, right? Because the performance is very different for the users. So a lot of those calls happen according to the growth, according to how users were responding.
How has this journey changed you?
So I think, you know, one thing I would say, a lot of articles you see in LinkedIn, a lot of success stories and all of those things, right? A lot of zazzy and glamorous things. But honestly, it's not an easy game, right? It's not. You would see way more failures, way more arguments, way more things not happening than things happening. And in that journey also, if you see, you would see that out of 10 things, only one thing would work. And that one thing is what you have to stick to and say that, okay, let me just figure out a way to scale it. So it makes you very, very strong. It kind of makes you strong, and it kind of gives you that wisdom that to not listen to everybody. I think early on in the journey when we started it, I used to think that maybe if 10 people are talking, let's listen to them and see if it's kind of going to work. But I think that you will have in this journey a lot of people who would give you their own piece of thought, but you should stick to what you are really building and who you are building for, instead of just listening to everybody, and then see what is useful, just build into that. Don't start implementing everything and everything. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. I've been down that rabbit hole previously. Right now, I think we don't necessarily have waves happening, but back in mid 2010s, you had waves. You had AI waves, you had AR waves, where you would see 100, 200 startups getting funded in that. We have that EdTech wave right now, to be honest.
EdTech and HealthTech is coming up now.
EdTech and HealthTech. And if you were in EdTech or HealthTech, and if you were taking a slightly different approach, it is impossible not to feel like a lunatic. Right? Because the investors would ask you that question. Potential investors would ask you that questions. Advisors would ask you that questions. The market would ask you that question.
Yeah.
And then why aren't you guys doing those things or saying those things or approaching those things? And then it takes a lot of wisdom and a little bit of quiet in the mind also to sit down and say, no, all of this is noise. Or maybe most of it is noise, and you have to have enough insight and some amount of hard work and working in the weeds to say, no, all of this is noise, and I'm going to separate the signal from the noise.
Yeah.
And this is the signal, and which is where, in some cases, the true north is the user saying, hey, we are building it for them. And this is exactly how we are serving them. We made that mistake in our previous venture, where the whole idea was people shop all the time. Even today, the funny thing is, locally in stores, a lot of merchants can offer discretionary discounts. But the tech crowd, for instance, and the Indian way of extracting that is a bargain, right? Yeah. So driving a hard bargain. But most people who are not local, let's say there are a lot of, in Bangalore, there are a lot of techies from out of town. They don't know the local lingo. Some of them hustle. But most part, when there is a label that's written with a price, most people don't argue. But if the store owner or a merchant wants more leads, you know, the way he can put out is through an offer. And if that offer is actually private, the funny thing is, stores can actually benefit and test out promotions and discounts if they are private and see, okay, what kind of users buyers do I get through this? But unfortunately, even today, you have a situation whereby most offers are public because nobody has built that private audience. They haven't built hordes of private users whereby they could say, okay, hey, I think this user is looking for something like these, or maybe there are groups of users. You could make an offer, and instead of having 50 footfalls, maybe we could convert it into 500 footfalls.
Got it.
So that space is what we set out to solve.
Got it.
Along the way, the hyperlocal wave swept us.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And today, just like you have, because of your size, you had to choose a category in personal and beauty.
Yeah.
We had 16 categories for which we were solving this problem quite mm-hmm. effectively. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, hyperlocal came in and merchants started telling us, no, it's not enough mm-hmm. for you to just show a deal. I want you to do much more than that. I'm getting offers from anybody and everybody saying that I'll enable commerce for you, local commerce for you. And then we went down that rabbit hole. And because food was actually quite heavily crowded, even today to a certain degree it is. And then the others were crowded. Book My Show had looked at and then local experience. We said, okay, what's local that is physical that needs footfalls? We said fashion. And when we looked at our data again, it showed that fashion was the second most frequented category. People were dying for deals there. And but we didn't stay true to that. It's a big lesson. And I call it the premature pivot and also premature scale, where you don't separate the noise from the signal from the noise, and then you end up making the wrong decision. Good for you that you've taken a different decision, and I think you're on the path to revenues and profitability soon. Awesome. What have been some decisions that you regret, and what have been some decisions that you've been sort of pleased with?
So I think decision I regret, I'm pleased with, would be that we move to this social commerce for. Oh, I'm so sorry. You need to just give me a second.
Sure.
I'm not sure how in my laptop this suddenly starts. Yeah, so sorry for that. I don't know. This is a big FM interview, just starts from nowhere. So I think from a good point of view, I would say that, like I was saying, right, being very emotional as a founder, founders are practical and both emotional fools. There are two characters which they have, right? That's the reason they keep going also, right? So they're very emotional to the idea or the product what they're building, right? So so I think one good thing is that we took a call during that time that everything else aside, but let's pivot or let's move to a social commerce for beauty and personal care. It was not that easy a call, but we still took that call and we started implementing it very early. I think from March, all of this happened, and April itself, we started testing it even with the brands much before our product was live. We started working on the new app. So that's something which was a very good call, I would say. From the something which I did not write personally, I would say, in the company is, I think my founder, co-founder always kept telling me that it's something about, right, that if something is not working from a person point of view, employee point of view, fire fast. I think that's one thing which I have not learned yet very good. It still takes me a lot of time. So you know what, I think, so let's say if I decide today that, you know what, I think this is not working, I'm not been working, I would not go and do that today itself. I would still go back, munch, think, is there a way, is there a way? And then I would take that call. So that's something which I think firing fast is something which I did not do and which I should have done, because when you're a small team of 15-20 people, right, you don't have a leeway of having even one person which is not working out.
Right.
So yeah.
I couldn't agree more with you. I am a person who gives a very, very long rope to people. In fact, the funny thing is, one of my foundational philosophies is find good people and you grow and make them grow with you. My thing is, let's find diamonds in the rough, because for some reason, and I've gotten pretty good success with it. Our designer in the previous startup was a guy who just couldn't converse in English.
Got it.
He would speak in Kannada. And the result was that the good part was all the three co-founders, all of us knew Kannada.
Got it.
But the tech head did not know Kannada. It created some amount of rift between the two of them. But the thing was, because of that, unfortunately for him, he couldn't find employment in the larger ones. But he was a terrific designer. So we had many square pegs in round holes. And my famous metaphor or analogy I can give is the analogy in Moneyball, which shows so many different mavericky players fit into one team, right? And I've built a team, but I've found that the notion of actually firing fast is important, both for the team as well as that particular individual. It is tough. It's a tough call. It's very different because we are also emotional beings. Yeah. We think, oh, maybe that person will get bad. Maybe they'll get better. Maybe they're in a wrong role. But trust me, in the current venture, the last few months, we've actually sometimes even let somebody go in as little as 2 hours.
Got it.
Somebody on the second day, we are actually going through one decision right now. And the longer you keep them, the tougher that decision is.
That's right.
And it's more damaging because both of you have emotional skin in the game. And there's so much history. The more history builds up, the tougher it becomes. But the quicker that it can go, it can happen. You can replace them. And I can absolutely relate to what you've or what you've said just right now. And what's the end game? What's the dream scenario here?
Dream scenario for us is to be the largest social commerce platform in India and outside. At least for now, it's in India for beauty and personal care category.
And what time horizon?
So we are looking to reach there in next 3 to 4 years of time.
Okay, by 2024, I suppose.
Yeah, we should be there.
2024, 25. Awesome. This do you read?
Yeah, I do.
What's on your reading list right now? Or what have been some books that you've loved of late?
So honestly, I read very different kinds of books. I read very kiddish kind of books also, and I read very business kind of books also. One of my favorite books is Predictably Irrational. I think I have read that book multiple times. I still love reading that. Yeah, that's right. I still love reading that book.
Yeah.
And I'm a big Harry Potter fan. So I have read Harry Potter series. I think I remember a month wherein I read all the 7 books after working for 14 to 15 hours.
Potterhead.
Awesome.
I remember reading Predictably Irrational, I think 2008 or 9 when it initially came out. There's another similar book called A Random Walk Down Wall Street, which is very interesting. But you know, the funny thing though is there are a bunch of books which are all around the same topic, which is human behavior, human emotion. And you will find this fascinating. Almost all these books are based on the work done just by 2 people. Daniel Kahneman.
Okay.
And Amos Tversky.
Okay.
I've read about 15 books on this subject.
Okay.
And then when I on the 4th or 5th book, I started looking at the references or the footnotes, and then they would say, in this particular experiment, Daniel Kahneman, Amos Tversky. I said, man, I can't believe, you know, a bunch of experiments, and they're not like 2000 experiments of Daniel Kahneman and Amos, right? It is about 8 to 10, and almost same experiments repeat. What I appreciated in these books were the different perspectives the authors could derive out of the same experiments. What I thought was, man, the source material must be so rich that it has spawned so many narratives around it. And the book that actually gets you to that is Thinking Fast and Slow.
Yeah, I have read that. Yeah, Thinking Fast and Slow. Yeah.
So, nice. And all of that began with a meeting of 12 people in a room. And that led to that book, but fascinating. These books are, I would say, almost like Bibles, if you have to understand human emotion and behavior and build something.
Yeah, I mean, specifically from a pricing point of view, it gives you so much insight about the user behavior.
Right. So, Neha, this has been a fantastic conversation.
Thank you so much.
Full of insights, rich insights. I know you have the basic tenets in place. When you scale the next peak, we'll come back and interview this Maharani of scale and see what the advantage
for
is like.
Wonderful speaking with
you. Awesome. Last words for people, women entrepreneurs and people starting out there.
So I think you would get a lot of setbacks. Keep your focus, I would say. Just keep focusing on what you're building and do it consistently. That's what matters in the end.
Awesome. We wish you the very best, Neha.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Krishna.
We hope you enjoyed this story. If this story made a difference to you, tell us by leaving a comment on the website or our social media channels. Help us spread the love by subscribing, liking, and sharing our show. We welcome speaker suggestions and collaboration. Write to me at tanya@maharajasofscale.com.